on.
Okay, mics are hot.
Yeah.
Say that the mics are hot, right? So we get started.
Herbert Business School, and very delighted to welcome you this morning to our Future of Leadership speaker series co-hosted with McKinsey. I have today with me Arvan Satpathy, who is in the Miami office of McKinsey, and he's going to do a few words of introduction, and then I'll join back in the conversation.
Thank you, Anne, and good morning, everyone. It's really a privilege for us to co-host this series with the University of Miami. As you know, the purpose of this is to highlight local businesses and local leaders that are really doing great stuff. I moved to Miami 3 years ago, and before I moved here, I kind of had this impression of Florida, or Southern Florida business community being real estate and tourism. And as I got here, I found all these wonderful companies, which are not just relevant at a local level, but really, really punching above their weight at a global level. And so one of them is HEICO. And it's a real privilege and pleasure to introduce Eric Mendelson, who is the co-president and on the board of HEICO. HEICO is a global aerospace and defense company. It's the largest producer of aftermarket parts that are FAA approved. It's got a terrific origin story. We'll hear about it. It started right here. With an acquisition in 1990 of a $25 million business that Eric, his brother Victor, and his dad led for $25 million. And 35 years later, it is really a global giant. Eric himself is a graduate of Columbia College and has been in this business since the beginning. Beyond his work at the company, he is on the board of Columbia College. He's on the board of Mount Sinai Hospital, and was the previous chairman of Ransom Everglades. So before I turn it over to Eric, and just to give you a sense of the company, let me just give you a slight fact and maybe ask a question. The fact is, if any of us had invested $100 in a broad stock market index, the S&P index or the Dow Jones index in 1990, it would have been roughly $3,000 now, roughly $3,000. So can anybody hazard a guess on if you had invested that same $100 in HEICO stock in 1990, what it would be worth now?
A lot more.
Yeah? A lot more for sure. Around 82,000. 82,000. So that's a lot more than 3,000. So whoever invested in it, I'm sure is very, 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 very happy. So with that, let me maybe, Eric, ask you, what is the secret of your success and your company's success? You know, start with how it started and what do you do?
Well, first of all, thank you very much for inviting me to be with you today. And thank you, everybody, for coming out, especially with the rain that we had this morning. And I hope I don't disappoint you with the conversation. But we are very grateful for the success that HEICO has had. The number that we like to quote, I think that this gentleman maybe was getting to, is for every $100,000 invested in HEICO when we took over and in the very beginning of 1990, has become worth over $82 million today. So a lot of people have done very nicely, including a number of folks in this room. But the way that we did it, first of all, we had no idea that this was going to happen. And we had much more modest goals when we started down this path. And we really just wanted to build a good, solid industrial business. And I don't know if you want me to get into that now.
Please, go ahead, yeah.
A little bit later. So I was born in New York, and I'm 58, and when I was 3 years old, my parents moved to Miami, to what's now Pinecrest. So I basically have lived here, with the exception of college and business school, for 55 years, so as close to a native as they come. My wife was born at Mount Sinai, all of our kids were born at Mount Sinai in Miami Beach, so we're really very much a Florida family. Anyway. My parents moved down here in the late 60s. My dad was an accountant with Arthur Andersen and then worked on Wall Street in New York, bringing companies public in the late 60s. And he had family, my mom's family was in the real estate business. They were prominent real estate developers. And although my dad didn't go into business with them, he was able to learn, you know, a fair amount about the business and ended up going into real estate. And pretty much on his own, along with his partner, over the next 10 years, became the largest condominium developer in the state of Florida. And as many people probably know, with the cycles that used to occur back then, people would do very well in real estate through the cycle, and then they'd tend to sort of go broke or give it back after the peak of the cycle. And my dad was, with a financial background, was determined not to do that, so he decided pretty much to get out at the top. And felt that without inflation and due to the overbuilding that had occurred in South Florida in the early 80s, that real estate didn't make as much sense. And with his financial background, decided to pivot to taking investments in publicly traded companies that were undervalued as interest rates were starting to go down. So at that time, Ronald Reagan had become president, and my brother and I were in high school. I went to Gulliver, just a few miles away from here. And we saw that while my dad's business was very interesting in this condominium conversion and development business, there was never anything that really remained beyond the financial gain. You build a building or convert a building, and sell it out, and it was financially rewarding, but there was nothing that remained. And Reagan was president, talking about the revitalization of America. America can make it again, and had to fix the Rust Belt. And actually, Victor and I ultimately went to Columbia College in New York, which operationally was not run very well. So we sort of figured out, well, if this is sort of how American business is run, we want to go into industrial business and really help contribute. So that's what we did. And long story short, ended up, HEICO was a publicly traded company on the American Stock Exchange, had $25 million market cap. And then long story short, after a proxy fight and some ensuing litigation, we got control of the company at the very end of 1989. And we had hoped to go in one particular direction, but due to a series of events, that was not going to be possible. And we sort of then pivoted, and I can get into that in some of the future questions as to what we ultimately, what we went into. But suffice it to say, we became the, I guess I should mention it now. When my dad, my brother, and I came to the company, we were very fortunate that on one of the early days that we were there, a salesman came into the office and, you know, we joke around that a lot of salesmen want to sell stuff that you don't have. They you talk to them about selling all the stuff you have, and then they come back and say, well, you know, what about, you know, we've got A, B, and C, but I want to sell X, Y, and Z. And so that's what this sales guy did, but he was absolutely right. And he brought in a consultant. And the consultant, we hired the consultant to analyze HEICO's capabilities and advise what we should do. And this gentleman was incredibly well-respected, had a great experience in the industry at manufacturers and overhaulers and airlines. And he recommended that we compete with the original manufacturers developing more parts. And that was very difficult to do at the time because the FAA wouldn't grant approval based on reengineering. And I'll never forget, he opens up his Code of Federal Regulations and he says, you know, 21303C, and the FAA will grant approvals based on testing computations necessary to prove to the administrator that the part is the same in the fit, form, and function. And he said, in the past, companies tried to accomplish that this way, but I think we can do it doing it this way, a different way. And my dad looked at him and said, well, basically the company is no other option. It was really struggling at the time. And the consultant said, Eric, you're a halfway good salesman. You just need to go up to the FAA and figure out how to convince them to go do this. So I was 25 years old, and I got, you know, was fairly hardworking and sort of figured it out. And with this consultant who I convinced to come on board as our chief operating officer, and he was 60 years old at the time. Wow. So I convinced him to stay until he was 70 when his wife made him retire. and then, of course, he remained as a close friend of the company and advisor to the company for the rest of his life. But he was the one who really came up with this idea to go to the airlines and offer them savings on parts where there were only monopolistic suppliers charging very high prices. So we were able to basically execute on that. And that was sort of the start of the company.
Awesome. So it sounds like the OEMs had a pricing umbrella that allowed you to get in, but you were able to work the regulators to your favor and get all the approvals and beat them at their own game, essentially.
Exactly. We joined the Aerospace Industries Association, which is basically all of the largest aerospace and defense manufacturers. Now, HEICO is the second smallest member. But it was through that process, there were a number of manufacturers who were trying to lock down and prevent companies from re-engineering parts. And I got involved in that whole process and sort of steered it in a very different direction where they were not able to do what they wanted to do. And actually from there, I met all the people at the FAA and showed them what our process was and why we thought we could accomplish it. And we had the company had a very good safety record prior to that. So unfortunately, we were able to convince them to do it.
Great.
So I'd like to, and the rest is history, right, up to today, built an incredible company. I'd like to talk a little bit about leadership, right? So you have, your company has a very unusual, you've said that it's not a family company, right? But you have a collective responsibility leadership sort of edict, which is that decisions are made unanimously among you, your brother, and your dad. Tell us a little bit about that, and then had you not had that policy in place all these years, what would HEICO look like instead?
So the way we got to that policy was when Victor and I were growing up, my father was always included us in his business activities. And even starting at the age of 7, I remember answering telephones in a sales office, in a condominium development sales office. And actually his partner came in and said, you know, Larry, this looks ridiculous. There's a 7-year-old here answering the phones and greeting people. I mean, literally, I was 7 years old. And so we always had this tremendous interest in business. The original plan was that my brother and I were going to go into business together, and my father would remain working with his then partner, who passed away tragically shortly before we started the HEICO project. And so Victor and I wanted to take over HEICO. We started buying the stock in HEICO in 1987 after the stock market crash and the price turned down. And then my father found himself without his longtime best friend and business partner. So of course we had no capital. We just had energy and enthusiasm, no experience. And so the three of us started working together. But so from day one, HEICO was not a family business. It was a publicly traded company where we had fiduciary responsibility to the shareholders. We were the largest shareholder, but we were just one of many. And we adopted the philosophy from day one that we, in order to make any major decision, the three of us all had to be on board. And that turned out to be a very good decision because we each look at different things. And we bring different strengths to the, none of us individually has all the answers. And so by requiring three votes, we're able to flesh out the issues. And I think one of the reasons HEICO has become successful is we've acquired 100 companies, and we basically have taken the cash from those businesses and compounded it by buying other successful businesses. And by requiring three votes, we've been able to avoid the meltdown or sort of going backwards problems that other people have had. So we bought 100 companies, and of the 100, 98 have been successful, somewhere between, I would say singles and home runs. And the two are sort of in transition, and time will tell, and hopefully we'll get those where they need to be. But by requiring the three votes, we've been able to sort of not lose money and not go backwards by making mistakes. We have missed out on some opportunities where we couldn't get three votes, but it's worked out.
Maybe building on that a bit, I've heard you say, if we are a $4 billion company, we're not really a $4 billion company, we are $140 million companies. And I think that kind of talks about how you think about empowering your businesses, empowering your people. You've said that when you buy businesses, you want people who are entrepreneurs and you want them to stay. The other thing I've also heard you talk about is you don't call your employees, you call them team members. And you have this attitude from corporate of how can I serve you? So can you talk a little about this notion of decentralization, empowering people, putting them at front, and from management team, you're trying to serve them. That's sure. A little different from how a lot of companies operate.
Yeah, I'd be very happy to mention that. So where the term team member came from was, I mentioned when we took over the company, we had to do a proxy fight. And one of the second largest shareholder group after our family was the team members of the company, the 401k plan. So during the proxy fight, I'd get all the team members together, and we were lobbying them to vote for us. And we developed a very, very good relationship with, they were called employees at the time. And so when we got control of the company, I was 24, Victor was 22. And to have employees when you're 24 and 22 sounds really demeaning. I mean, they're going to work for two people who haven't worked before, don't know what they're doing. And so we just came up with the idea that we wanted to call them team members, and rather than sort of what we viewed as a demeaning term. And that stuck. And then early on, we put 10% of the company's stock in the 401k plan. We gave it as a gift to the 401k plan, and it was going to be repaid through company donations or company contributions to team members' individual 401k accounts through profit sharing and a 401k match. And we had a lot of confidence that the stock was going to go up. And as a result of that, that those shares that we put into that plan have become worth over $2 billion. And today, when people retire from HEICO, when a lot of the long-serving people retire, they retire with seven or eight-digit 401k account balances, in addition to what they've been able to save. And we've just viewed very strongly that we're all in this together. Everybody has a job to do. My dad, my brother, and I are not greedy people, and we want to make sure that we, spread the benefit and, frankly, expect people to work very hard. I mean, HEICO's not a place for people to come to work and just sort of have a good time and relax. The people who are at HEICO, we expect to be, very, very disciplined, very conscientious, work really hard. And if they're going to do that, we want them to share in all of the benefits. So that's really been the approach. As the company started becoming successful, we were generating cash. And if we were a private company, probably we would have taken the money and invested it in other things or bought stuff with it. But since it was a public company, most of it didn't belong to us. So we, as part of our thought of building a larger enterprise, we were very comfortable with other like-minded entrepreneurs who were used to, you know, taking sort of small resources, figuring out what you can do with it, and end up doing it better and creating a satisfying a need for the customer. And we became pretty good at that, and pretty good at identifying other businesses that had similar attributes. So when, you know, just as we wouldn't like people sitting on top of us telling us what to do and, you know, micromanaging us, when we found these successful businesses, by and large, we do a lot of homework up front, get to know them really well, and then we let them go do their thing. And we want to make sure that they're motivated and they really enjoy what they're doing. And, you know, as I mentioned, my wife is doing her PhD in intrinsic motivation in business. And one of the things that she's studying, which we have sort of done instinctively at HEICO, and she came to it independently, not because of HEICO, is that if you take people who are who have mastered their fields and are really, really good at it and succeed, and you combine that with autonomy, and you don't tell them what to do. You know, there's multi. You can drink water, you can drink sparkling water, you can drink Coca-Cola, coffee. There's no right answer. But a lot of these big companies decide, well, we got to standardize, we've got so many people, we have to organize it that way. We don't do that. And we believe much more strongly in, you know, the power of motivation and autonomy. And if you've got good people, they're able to make good decisions. If you've got bad people or a bad business, then you can't leave them alone. That's a recipe for disaster. But if something is successful, you know, we joke around that one of the core competencies at HEICO is we don't mess things up. we may not invent the new iPhone, but we're not going to mess things up, and we're not going to go backwards. So that's been really very core. And yeah, HEICO is roughly $4 billion a year in sales this year, with roughly $1 billion of EBITDA, $950 million of EBITA, $22 billion market cap. But it doesn't operate as a single integrated business like a Boeing or a Delta Airlines. It operates more like 100 $40 million businesses, each with 100 people, the total 10,000 people. But within those 100 person pods, and some have as few as 10, some have as many as 1,000 people, but within those groups, they really drive a lot of autonomy, and they expect people to really perform at a different level. And when they do perform at that level, they really appreciate it.
So autonomy is really important, especially if you've got great people. But can you speak a little bit about how mentorship factors into making sure that you're getting the right outcomes and how you get people to be that autonomous and successful at the same time? I know you have your own mentorship story.
Yes, the gentleman who I mentioned, who we were fortunate enough to arrive on the same day at HEICO, his name was Jim Rehm. And he's the person who came from General Electric and United Airlines and a number of other very well distinguished aerospace companies. And I was very fortunate in that I was 25 years old. My dad had a financial background, was more of a financier, numbers guy. My brother was in law school here at the University of Miami. And we had a lot of existential challenges at HEICO. And Jim at the time was 60 years old, and he had this whole, well, he had retired prematurely due to a health issue, which he had overcome, and he was just looking to give back, and he wasn't trying to remake the world, but he just wanted to share his information. I was 25 years old, and I had a lot of energy, but no experience doing anything. So we made a very good team, and I joked around, I was the energy, he was the brains. And we figured out, he was the one who came up with the idea, and then we went out together to the airlines and convinced them that, hey, if we could do all of this, would they buy those parts from us? And got them to commit, which was a little more complicated than it sounds. And then we had to go out and hire engineers and start figuring out this design process in order to do it. And it's one thing to develop a design process where you're doing very few sort of one-off approvals. It's another thing to have a process where you're doing hundreds, and you've got to make sure that you've got all the belt and suspenders in there, and you don't end up having door plugs flying off an airplane and, you know, that kind of a thing. So we worked very closely together, and Jim was very generous with his time, and it worked. It's got to be both ways. I think that he has since passed away, but I think he got a lot of energy and enthusiasm from me, and he saw me running around the world doing all this stuff. And I, you know, respected his ideas and concepts in terms of quality and technical superiority. And we learned things along the way. We had various challenges, and we put in processes back 34 years ago that we still have in place today and are still the reason behind HEICO's success. And just to give you an idea of one of them, I remember being in the office with him until like 8 o'clock at night, every single night, sometimes midnight, a lot of times midnight. And the head of manufacturing comes upstairs and he says, "Oh, Eric and Jim, I got a real problem. Why, what's the matter? We made this part out of, you know, we're supposed to make it out of AMS 5662, a certain type of material. And the mill sent us the material. There's a certification there that says it was this the correct material. But now they're contacting me 6 months later and saying it was wrong. And instead of 5662, it was 5660. And we look at each other like, oh my God, what are we supposed to do now? We've now shipped thousands of parts to, you know, dozens of airlines, and who knows what the difference is going to be. So we was very scared, and we did this whole technical analysis and discovered that there wasn't that much of a difference, and it wasn't going to be was not going to have an impact in performance. But from there, Jim recommended we now need to put in material analysis. So before we ship parts, we don't just accept certifications from our vendors, but instead we destructively test at least one part from every single lot or heat that comes in. And we do the microstructure, macrostructure, coatings, hardness, dimensions, everything that there is to do. And we put that in place then. And that has saved HEICO, and, you know, knock wood, we've shipped about 85 million parts since then without a single in-flight shutdown, without a single airworthiness directive against our parts. And that's just an example of one of the, but that came from this whole mentorship. And if it weren't having, you know, sort of that combination, that ability of the two people to work together to solve those kinds of problems, I don't think we would have gotten here.
I know we want to talk a little bit more about the business, and I'll give you a chance, yeah. Orbin, but on that note, what about the third generation?
So the third generation is very excited and interested in going in HEICO, into HEICO. There are six members of the third generation. Our oldest daughter got married a few years ago. We just became grandparents about 4 months ago. And she's an elementary school science teacher, so she's not going to come into the business. But our son, who's 26 years old, is responsible for acquisitions at HEICO. He's a very talented young man, went to Columbia, got his degree in 3 years, majored in physics and neuroscience, and then got his MBA in 1 year, came in, ran one of the HEICO businesses for 2 years, and now runs acquisition. So he's very capable and working on integrating one of the companies right now, so he's already in. Then we have a 17-year-old son who is a junior in high school at Ransom. He would like to come in, and then I think my nephew, Alex, who's working for an investment banking firm up in New York, would be interested in joining. But certainly there is no, you know, HEICO is not an easy ride. And if you're part of the leadership, you need to not only perform, but you need to sacrifice and really show that, you know, what you're willing to do. I mean, nobody can come into the company because of their last name. Fortunately, we don't have that issue. The next generation, I think at HEICO, Peter sort of knows this, but at HEICO, each successive generation is more motivated than the prior. I don't know why that occurs, but probably some mental problem.
Maybe I'll ask one more business question looking a little bit into the future, but reflecting on your past. You know, you started at $25 million, you are $4 billion. A lot of it is organic growth. You described the processes, the FAA certification, and so on and so forth. But a lot of it has been acquisitions. And you said your son is driving acquisitions in one of the segments. So maybe two parts to this question is, when you acquire companies, you are a serial acquirer. You've done 100 acquisitions. So what do you look for What makes you so good at it? What is the secret sauce? And then maybe the second part is, as you think about the next generation, and hopefully they'll have the same level of value creation as you and your brother and your father did, are there acquisition candidates available? What's the scene look like?
So we are grateful that things have worked out so nicely, because we've had to place a number of bets, and you never know. Things can go multiple ways. But the first thing that we look for is good people, because we fundamentally believe there's no such thing as good business with bad people. You can only do good business with good people, period. And if it's not somebody who we would invite to our house for Thanksgiving dinner, as the saying goes, we don't want to buy their business. Because invariably, they will cut corners, they will do things that are not for the long-term health of the business. And at HEICO, everything we do, and even starting in the early days, and for the first 5 years, the results were not good, but we were putting into place all of the things which ultimately made us successful. So number one, good people. Number two, they have to be good businesses. And we define a good business as something typically with 20% margin or higher. That's not a definite rule, but the thought is if somebody can earn 20% on sales consistently, they must be doing something unique. And so we do that. We also are now in so many, my brother and I also, and father, approach things very much with a beginner's mind. And we never want to assume that we know more than anybody else. We keep our ears open, and always, you always want to learn. The moment you think you don't have anything to learn, watch out. And so we do that. But then we have been fortunate enough that we grow in what we call these adjacent white spaces. So we don't go do something totally different than we're doing now. We may venture out a little bit, like a half a step, but not totally out. But HEICO has grown from very small to now we have these 100 businesses. So when we find the adjacent white spaces today are a lot larger. And while we're, quite grateful with the success of HEICO, it's only a $4 billion, it's a lot of money, but it's only a $4 billion company. This is, I don't even know the size of the industry, but maybe it's hundreds of billions, a trillion, I don't know, but it's very large. And we are tiny, we're nothing. And so we think that there's a lot of area to grow. But the other thing that we realize we're not is we're not an integrator. We are good at running 100-person businesses, and we're where they can get intimate with their products and really be a category killer and sell that product to everybody and do it better than everybody else on the face of the planet. We are not able to develop a new airplane, or to build an airline, or to build an engine. That requires incredible skill set that we just don't possess. We sort of stick to, we understand the kinds of things that we're capable of doing. Not a very sexy answer, but that's the truth.
It works.
It works.
So what would be your advice to the crowd about how to build a great business then?
First of all, do something that you love. Not every day is going to be successful or fun. So it has to be something at the end of the day that you enjoy doing, number one. Number two, be surrounded with people who you really love being with. Because if you're not happy being with them and working with them, it's not going to work. It becomes work. The old saying, you don't have to work a day in your life if you do something that you really love is very, very true. And so that would really, be my advice. And work very hard. Nothing comes for free. And everything requires a tremendous amount of sacrifice. And then even when you sacrifice, sometimes you get it wrong. And you just have to keep on working very hard. But as long as you work hard and you're transparent, there's a lot of, this is the greatest country on the face of the earth and the history of the earth, because we have this kind of opportunity here that I truly believe that if you work hard in the United States, you can get ahead. It doesn't matter, where you've come from. In the United States, everybody is about growth and opportunity and frankly making money. And if you can make somebody money, that in a proper way, that's all people care about. So
A tribute to capitalism.
A huge tribute to capitalism.
So I think we have a few students out in the audience, and I know they always enjoy hearing from our guests. What kinds of skill sets and sort of personality attributes are you looking for when you hire? I know you're not involved in HR anymore, but what generally today do you think are the most pressing needs for young people coming in as you know in a new career?
I would say the most important, well, a number of things. Number one, you got to work hard. And anybody who thinks something is going to be handed to them or they should be entitled to something for any reason whatsoever is wrong. And that is not how HEICO operates. I mean, HEICO people do very well because they work very, very hard. And our shareholders are very happy for that that effort. But I think approaching things with the beginner's mind is really critical. You know, we all may think we have the answer, but you've always got to keep your ears open and learn and listen and never get sort of mired down or stuck down in that. I would say, you know, obviously a good education, you need to learn the tools. You know, being a good person, open mind, those are, I would say, the skills.
Terrific, terrific. Well, I know our audience is anxious to ask questions, so I think we've got some microphones going around and happy to let you have at it. Right here.
Hi.
We got a microphone coming.
The Wencor acquisition. So that's not a 100-person company. That's what thousands of people.
Exactly.
How is that working, and what are some of the milestones you had to go through to make that work?
So, great question. So, and I like to joke around that if we were really so smart, we could have bought Wencor 25 years ago for about $50 million. We paid $2 billion, $50 million last year for it. So, we're really not that smart. Of course, it's a very different company than it was 25 years ago. Wencor was our, you know, was a peer in the marketplace, and the companies were always rivals. And we sort of focused in different areas. So the opportunity really was to take what both companies did, put it together, and offer a bigger product to the customer. And that's what's worked out. But you're right, Wencor, where the acquisition is going extraordinarily well, way beating the numbers. But the interesting thing about Wencor is it is 1,100 people, but it's operated more like 1,100 person businesses. So it's a lot more like HEICO than you know than a single integrated business. The customers are very happy because we've been able to broaden the product line and really offer significantly more savings in terms of parts and component overhaul distribution than we were able to individually. And actually, I have to call out the private equity firm that put Wencor together, Werber Pincus, did really a very good job because they kept it very entrepreneurial. And we had known Warburg over the years and had friends over there. And they looked at HEICO, they sort of liked the model. So when they were assembling Wencor, they assembled it in the model of HEICO. Not because they were trying to help HEICO out, but they thought that was sort of their path. HEICO would end up being able to be the best acquirer for the company, which you know we turned out to be. So that's worked out very well, and we have businesses here locally, and Wencor does, that are cooperating very well with the HEICO businesses. They're able to rationalize product lines, share people, do all sorts of things. So it's really worked out well. Thank you.
Right here.
So I was going to ask the same question about the Wencor acquisition, but I know one of the criterion that you use for acquisitions is that they should be accretive within the first year in terms of, I guess, the bottom line, whatever. So I presume from your answer that it has been. I went to business school in the 1960s, okay, so forgive me for that. But back then, conglomerates were kind of the rage, and just Tyco, not HEICO, blah, blah. And that didn't work out very well. But I think the difference, if I gather right, is that that was very disparate industries, not necessarily somehow integrated into the main frame like HEICO does. And I know you've expanded into MilGov and other things, and I'm not sure exactly how you figure out what will morph well. But let me see if there's a question here. actually, I have one unrelated question. I'm just curious about the company, the direction that you decided in the beginning to pivot away from, if you.
Okay, sure. So your first comments. So HEICO is in aerospace and defense and electronic technologies. But if you look at our revenue, 87% is aerospace and defense. 13% is industrial. And the industrial businesses that we get into, we like to have similar stickiness, you know, with regard to their customers, margins that the aerospace and defense business has. So I would say HEICO, while we're in the two lines of businesses, flight support and electronic technologies, it's still within that aerospace and defense, and we still are very focused. We, you know, as I said, we believe in beginner's mind. We like to look at everything. But we have not found businesses or significant businesses outside of that area that have made sense for HEICO to go into. I don't rule it out because, frankly, a third leg on the stool has been something aspirational for a long time. But it's got to be the right leg. And we don't want to venture out and do something that we will later regret. You know, I mentioned that I think one of the things HEICO's been good at is we don't burn money. So we don't. We won't. We may miss an opportunity, but we typically won't crash either. So we haven't found it, but I think there are some opportunities. But we've got to sort of pick and choose. I think the conglomerates that got out of control started going into so many different areas and got too diversified, where they really didn't have that same. They weren't maintaining the knowledge, and they also didn't permit the same autonomy. You know, whether you look at GE or Tyco or whatever, I mean, all of these companies imposed their way of doing things, which didn't really work. And it was great for investors and for stock analysts, and they could, you know, call it a program and figure out how to give it a higher multiple and all that stuff. But it didn't really improve the business at the end of the day. So we've been careful. Yeah, not to do that. And then I'm sorry, the second part of your question was?
The direction in 1989.
Oh, yeah. So when we took over HEICO, it was in the aviation business with one subsidiary, making one part, and one type of part for one particular type of engine. And then it was also in the laboratory products business, building ovens, washers, incubators, dryers, for basically labs. So here at the University of Miami, you've got all these labs, you know, biomedical labs, and they'd make all that equipment that went in there. And when we were taking over the company, there was that business had about $20 million assets, and it was losing about $1 million a year. And sort of one of the disappointments, we wanted to work with it and to turn it around. But one of the things we had to agree to as part of the settlement where we got control of the company was that the former board cut a deal to sell the business to somebody who was really a better home for it, that was more knowledgeable about it. So we had to agree as part of the, they didn't want us messing with trying to get that business to perform. And they said, okay, we'll settle with you, but you have to agree to do this. So we said, okay, we'll do that. That also gave the company, in hindsight, $20 million of cash, which actually then we used half of to buy in a third of our stock, which turned out to be a pretty good investment. And then we used the other cash to build and grow and fund what we did. So that's why we ended up having to go down that path.
I think there's one here and here.
With so many experience in acquisitions, I think sometimes you have decided not to buy one company or other companies because of their price. What is the kind of multiples or valuation methods or strategies that you consider for going ahead and say, this is a good deal and I will go for it?
So it's
which
a great,
one I will reject?
It's a good question. We are very financially oriented. And we do have a rule that all acquisitions need to be accretive within the first year and preferably in the first year of acquisition. So we look at what our cost of capital is. We historically have not given out stock. So the way HEICO, the stock has performed so well is we've kept the share count consistent and we haven't issued new shares. And so instead what we've done is we've had revolving lines of credit where we're able to draw on them. And typically HEICO is run at about 1x debt to EBITDA, so very under-levered. And our dad coming out of the real estate business knows what, you know, leverage is very good if things are going up. If things are going down, not so much. And so we've always wanted to be very, very careful to not subject HEICO to that kind of situation. So we look at what our cost of capital is based on the revolving line of credit, or now we're investment grade issue. We had to issue some bonds to acquire Wencor. So we look at that. We run our model. And historically, we were we were very careful not to pay above a certain price for a business. With Wencor, actually, we probably paid the highest multiple that we ever paid. So it was 12.9x, which for us was massive. For the industry, not so much. And actually, the company has so outperformed that the effective multiple is significantly lower than that, and you know, maybe in the single digits. So it's worked out very well because of all the synergies that we've had with HEICO. Without integrating the business, we've still been able to get all sorts of benefits to grow it. But we are very financially oriented, and we don't want to make assumptions that are not right. And the other thing is, if you've got sellers who really care about the company, they know there's no free lunch. And so if somebody overpays for a business, the employees, the customers, the suppliers are all going to end up paying. And so we're very open and honest about that. You know, you want to get the top dollar, you want to strangle this company, is that really what you want to do to your people? Because invariably, you know, they're the employees are the ones who really suffer. So we've been careful to not get in, you know, get in that environment. But I do have to say that our most successful businesses, ironically, have been some of the highest multiple. Some of our most successful have been the highest multiple prices that we've paid, but it made sense.
This one over here.
Two quick questions for you. Firstly, if you had one lesson or one skill that you would attribute your success to, what would it be and why?
It's a good question. So for me, I would say being open and honest. And sometimes people can take advantage of me for that because I, you know, may reveal too much. But what we've learned at HEICO is that by having people comfortable with us, they want to do business with us. And if you're growing, fundamentally, the next deal is going to be bigger than the prior deal. So we've left, if you will, a lot of money on the table by, you know, treating people well and doing that. But I think by being transparent, that's very motivational to investors, lenders, team members, partners. And we've been able to work with all of those groups, and I think it's because they were comfortable with us. We weren't the smartest guys in the room. We're always, you know, very careful at HEICO. You know, whenever someone thinks they're the smartest one in the room, watch out, because very few are. And then
do you have a favorite book? Secondly,
favorite book? Not really, but not really. No, just sort of figure it out as we go along the way.
What was your favorite class in business school?
Good question.
to your point.
My favorite class in business school. Wow.
Sorry to catch you.
No. Probably something in accounting and finance. Mm-hmm. Is something in accounting and finance. I can't honestly say that there was a single favorite book or business school. You know, I mean business class. Sort of, you know, learning all that stuff and Right. Putting it all together.
Well, you said the company itself is, and you and your brother both very finance oriented.
Yes.
So I'm glad you tipped the hat to accounting.
By the way, in thinking the two questions put together, one of the things that does come to mind is Adam Smith's Wealth of Nations, and with the specialization of labor and, you know, some of the concepts that he had in there. I can't remember all what they are, but I do remember for many years thinking a lot about that.
Yeah, yeah, good answer. Yeah. Get a hold of a copy of that.
Yeah, very old.
What else?
Are you still having fun?
Very much so. At the end of the day, you've got to have fun. You got to enjoy what you're doing. You have to like the people who you work with. Not every day is wonderful. You know, one of the ways that we've been able sort of to keep the entrepreneurs is that when things are going well, it's relative. You know, when people are succeeding, that's a relatively easy time in business. So I would say today is an easy time in business. When things turn down and every day is a slog, that's the time that you really need to be motivated, and you've got to make sure that all your people are motivated, because a lot of the folks who have sold their businesses to HEICO, they don't have to work anymore. I mean, they've made tens, hundreds of millions of dollars, and they don't need, you know, the salary and the bonus and the stock options and whatever else. And if we don't create an environment where they enjoy what they do, they don't need to do it, and they won't do it. So we try, I would say, very hard, not through, you know, phony type of stuff and, you know, what I'll call BS team building activity, but instead just the way that they're treated day in and day out. And I think the autonomy drives a lot of that. You know, I like to say that if we tell somebody what to do and then they hit a wall, they're just going to give us the keys back and say, go clean it up, it's your problem. And yet, if we don't tell them what to do and they sort of have problems, and they're good people, they feel an obligation. So you gotta love what you do or don't do it. So
I think that just prompted a couple more questions.
I knew very little about HEICO until this morning, and your story is really inspiring. And I'm impressed that you, who liked accounting and finance in business school, was mentored by a manufacturing operations guy, and you embraced process improvement. That's what HEICO does, from all I can tell. Now I want to shift to the question. Your father was the leader. He had a great background, starting off at Arthur Andersen, as did I. Did he stay out of your hair from the standpoint of operations and simply act as the CFO in saying, this isn't so good, and you might want to try cutting back on debt, et cetera? How that's a tough relationship, father and two sons. Tell us a little bit about how that worked out.
So that's a great question. So my father's focus historically was accounting and finance, and he's got that background. But he's also incredibly smart, and he figures out what needs to be done. So I can tell you that when we took over the company, there were two remaining subsidiaries of the company, one of which I was basically running, which was the parts design and the parts manufacturing business. There was sort of no design back then. But we had another sort of OEM subcontractor building to print for the large OEMs. And that company was very, very troubled. And my dad, with his accounting and finance background, still, I'll never forget, got in there and set up these spreadsheets for the head of the business on root cause analysis. And, you know, when we finished this job, there was a negative gross margin of this, and why, and what were we going to do to fix it? And so he was very much oriented in that. But his interest was really in, still to this day, has not been operations. His interest is more building and growing and sort of more financially oriented. I always had an interest in operations. Why? I really don't know, but I did. And this mentor of mine sort of came at it from a very different angle. And he, you know, my whole family was accounting and finance and that kind of thing. And this guy had this Midwestern industrial focus. And it really resonated with me. It was just something that I was interested in. And my dad wasn't interested in that, so it worked out very well. But my dad also was very wise in that he understood that to micromanage somebody was not his style and really made no sense. And he wanted very much to mentor my brother and me, but not tell us what to do on a day-to-day basis. And I think it becomes difficult for a father-son relationship to be that mentor-mentee relationship, because you know there's all sorts of dynamics in there. Whereas somebody on the outside, and I even noticed this with my own son, and you know, despite you know all the experiences, David will come to me with a problem, and he'll ask me what I think, and I'll tell him the solution, and then I'll start telling him what to do, and he bristles. And it's not the same as a non-family member telling him what to do, where it can be more of a collaborative idea and you come to this the answer. So my dad was very good with I think his natural interest and also just his style of you know letting us try and go do our let us go do our thing. The same way with my brother. And that continues to this day, where we each sort of focus on our area of expertise.
Okay, last question.
Thank you for coming. We hear a lot about the progress of China in the aerospace industry. And I was wondering, to what extent do you think that China will become a real threat to your industry? You mentioned that you are very tiny, et cetera, but we hear that the reports of a very amazing progress on aerospace for them. Mm-hmm. And I wonder what kind of steps are you taking to prevent being a affected by their progress?
Yeah, it's a great question. So I remember about 25 years ago, we were working on a joint venture, which didn't happen with a company. And they told me they had a joint venture with another company in China. And they told me a story about they brought all their technology, they were manufacturing all the stuff. It was basically roughly a 50-50 JV. And the Chinese partner, after a couple of years, wanted more than 50%. And they wanted, you know, 60%, 70%. And the Western partner said, no, you know, I'm not going to do this. Forget it. And after a number of years, the Chinese partner said, here, to the Western counterpart, here, hop in the car, I want to show you something. So they get in the car, they literally go around the block to another factory, they walk in the factory and they say, you know, on the factory we have with you, we own it 50%. But you see this one, which by the way was a carbon copy of the first one, we own this 100%. And this is, yeah, so that, when I was told that story, we were much smaller, and it scared the heck out of me. And we've been very careful. We do not have any operations in, any manufacturing operations in China. We have sales offices, but we don't have manufacturing. And not because I have anything against the Chinese, quite the contrary. I've been there many, many times and really enjoyed the time, and I really have a lot of respect for what the Chinese have accomplished. But HEICO will not operate in an area where our data is not protected, you know, full stop. It's just, we're too small, there are too many other opportunities, we're just not going to do it. So we've stayed out of that. Having said that, we do sell a lot of stuff into China, and we are happy to partner and work with the Chinese, but on a way where nobody takes each other's stuff. And with regard to, I think where you may be going with regard to large commercial airplanes, they're really hard to manufacture. And I feel really badly for what Boeing is going through right now. I mean, yes, they made some mistakes that they shouldn't have done, but these are Herculean projects. And to do what Boeing does or what Airbus does is absolutely amazing. And there are no other companies on the planet that can do what they do or what GE, Rolls, and Pratt do. I mean, it's very, very unique technology. So I think it's going to be a very long time until the Chinese have a self-sufficient aircraft and engine business. Maybe aircraft, it will take at least 20 years, if at all. But remember, Boeing and Airbus, they're not standing still. And so, you know, maybe 20 years from now, the Chinese will be able to manufacture what Boeing and Airbus make today. But as far as the engine technology, it's going to be, I don't think in my lifetime, frankly. And I hope to live a long time. But
great final note. Well, listen, thank you so much for everyone stopping in this morning to our series. We will be on a pause until the fall, but we'll welcome you back to our series in the fall as well. Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.